and we have to really escalate the noise we make so that we'll be heard.
Happy Valentine's Day. I'm Andy Hum.
I'm Ann Northrup, and by the time you see this, I'm sure we'll be long past Valentine's Day, and you'll be saying, what the hell was he talking about?
Well, it's Valentine's Day today.
Yes, it is.
And when we're taping, and you should know that.
And okay.
We start with some bad news about love from Bermuda, because they've become the first country in the world to rescind same-sex marriage after it was legalized. And the U.S. religious right played a prominent role behind the scenes.
Well, they're claiming they did. I think a lot of that's PR, but we'll get to that shortly. Meanwhile, Mike Pence, our vice president, has been stalking gay figure skater Adam Rippon at the Olympics.
Could it be love?
Well, I don't know. Maybe he was so devastated that's why he's come back to the U.S. now before the Olympics are over. But Rippon has won at least one medal by now.
Betsy DeVos, our education secretary, has made it official. The department will no longer protect transgender students trying to use restrooms in accord with their gender identities.
Sweet. Virginia Republicans, also sweet, in the House of Delegates, have killed four LGBT bills passed by the Senate.
And it's not the first time.
Yeah.
An elementary school principal in Massachusetts has come out as transgender, and all seems to have gone pretty well.
That is a sweet story. But not so sweet again. An elementary school teacher at a Catholic school in Miami married her female partner, and guess what? She got fired.
We have reports of two more murders of transgender women in Buffalo and Jacksonville.
And we have a fascinating video, men of color opening up about facing stereotypes on gay dating apps.
And some insurance companies are denying long-term and disability policies to people who take PrEP. Don't take PrEP, you can have the policy.
It's weird. So we'll debate that. But we'll start in Bermuda.
Well, I guess we should start with Mike Pence and what. We're going to start with Bermuda. I apologize.
He told me we're starting with Bermuda, and then he tried to backtrack.
Bermuda. It's terrible.
Well, the thing is that they've been fighting for marriage for a while now, and they finally, after a lot of public back and forth and the legislature hating it, got a court to legalize same-sex marriage last year, and some couples got married. But then the legislature said, we're not letting you get away with that, and they passed a law after a public referendum saying, no, you can have domestic partnerships, but we're taking marriage away from you.
Yes, and the big ongoing controversy was whether the governor general, who was appointed by the queen or the parliament in Britain, whether he was going to sign this. And he did. His name is John Rankin. There he is in a previous. That's not him doing his.
On the left.
Yeah, he's the white guy. And this is a.
In the hat.
This is a black majority country.
Yes.
Bermuda. So. It is the first country to rescind. The voters in California also rescinded in 2008, but they're not a country
bypassing
yet.
Prop 8, and then that got overruled.
Now, here's the thing. They are saying that the marriages that have been performed since May, they're still married. You people can still be married. And if you're from elsewhere and you were married before we rescinded it, we'll recognize you, a gay couple, we'll recognize you as married too.
Because you're special.
Now, the former attorney general there, Mark Pettengill, who represented the gay couples who sued over this, said, you know, he's thinking about appealing to the European Court of Human Rights. There are actually two more layers in Bermuda that he could be appealing to as well. They're looking at their options because this was, even though this was the Supreme Court of Bermuda, there's two things above the Supreme Court.
And the other thing is that it took a while for the Governor General to sign this law because the British government was trying to decide whether or not to approve of signing this law that rescinded marriage and gave domestic partnerships. And the British government eventually okayed that on the grounds that the European Union doesn't specifically require marriage. It requires rights for same-sex couples, but
that's
not
true.
Marriage. So they and they have this whole thing about sovereignty of their territories. So they decided in the end that even though they hated doing it, they would allow this law to become law. Well, now there's an uproar in Britain over this. The British people, to some extent, are offended by their government having allowed this to happen.
Just like we want to see what happened with Rob Porter, they want to see what happened behind the scenes about this.
So there is some pressure now on the British government to exercise their authority, which they have, to declare marriage legal in all their territories. There are another half dozen places like the Cayman Islands and other territories that also don't have legal same-sex marriage. So this can go a number of ways. It can stay as it is with domestic partnerships. It can be challenged in court at other levels, both in Bermuda and in Europe. And the British government could decide to go ahead and impose marriage equality on its own edict. So we'll keep an eye
now,
on this.
The National Organization for Marriage did do some work behind the scenes on this and are trying to claim some credit for it because they say this is the first of many that they're going. They're never giving up. They're not giving up in the United States.
This has always been a fundraising effort. The right wing used to raise a lot of money on abortion, and for the last couple of decades, they've raised money on us.
And they have restricted abortion rights. And
yes, and, but they haven't gotten rid of abortion.
And in this country, at least right now, they're certainly working on limiting our marriage rights in various ways, if they can,
sure.
in terms
of gonna,
benefits.
They're going to continue to try.
And they're working, and they're going to get, if Trump has his way, a Supreme Court that is going to overturn it.
And they're certainly working around the world on a daily basis to try to stand in our way to stop marriage equality or to get rid of it. But I also can't give full credit to their claim that they are responsible for this. Brian Brown visited with the anti-marriage forces in Bermuda twice.
What's the origins of this? Who did it occur to that, hey, you know, we've got a court decision that says we have to do it, but maybe we don't have to do it? I mean,
you think they needed Brian Brown to tell them that?
Why did they accept it in May?
We don't know yet.
All right.
Perhaps we will send, Robert Mueller there to find out after he finishes with Trump.
Mike Pence can just not take no for an answer. The gay guys at the Olympics, Adam Rippon and Gus Kenworthy, they don't want to meet with him. They don't want to talk to him. Here's the thing about Mike Pence. He seems to want to really clear up this canard. This fake news that he is for conversion therapy because of something he said about basically about
changing sexual behavior.
Yes. Now, he might be right about that he didn't, in that statement, endorse conversion therapy. But why doesn't a reporter just say to him, well, do you support conversion therapy or not? And what about the other LGBT issues?
Well, that's
where do you
the thing.
Stand on those?
That's the thing is to focus on this was Adam Rippon's mistake to cite him as being in favor of conversion therapy when there are so many other things that he clearly did.
Yeah.
And so Pence has taken advantage of that to focus on the issue of conversion therapy and avoid the questions about discrimination and everything else.
Look, he's been, as he says, I'm busy practicing skating. Don't bother me about a meeting.
Right.
But if you Google Mike Pence and gay, there was a huge number of stories that came up and a meme that came up that he, thinks that we should be deprogrammed. That went around as soon as he was nominated for vice president.
But again, so, based on this statement that funds, the whole original thing was that he wanted money taken away from HIV and AIDS funding and diverted to changing people's sexual behavior.
Right.
Now, Adam Rippon and others have interpreted that as him endorsing conversion therapy. He says, no, it was just about abstinence.
We've advocated for changing your sexual behavior all along. We want you to be safe.
Exactly. But the real issue with Pence is taking away money from HIV and AIDS funding, promoting taking away non-discrimination laws, opposing same-sex marriage, et cetera, et cetera.
Or as Donald Trump says, Mike here wants to kill you.
Anyway, so
in the White House,
Adam Rippon and Gus Kenworthy and other out LGBT athletes have been a big story at the Olympics. And there are Adam on the left and Gus on the right.
And they're Ralph Lauren outfits, which is the uniform for the
He's been doing
Olympics.
Uniforms for the U.S. Olympic teams for years. But they just met. They had not met before, but they both were the U.S. out gay athletes at the games. So there they are getting to know each other and enjoying that. And then Adam started to compete, and the first competition he was in was the team skating competition. So the entire team of all these countries have, you know, one single men skater, right. One single women, one pairs, one ice dance.
Now, we just had the picture of him up in one of his outfits. I'm not remembering her name. She's not a regular on the CBS Morning News going, well, a lot of people think that he lost points because of that flamboyant outfit.
Have you watched skating?
Yeah.
That's mild compared to some of them.
Okay.
But
nice.
He looked great, and he did a great job.
And we're glad he's eating again.
And he helped the team, the U.S. team, take the bronze in the team competition.
And there is their joyous reaction to winning the team event. And
they won the bronze in the team event.
Yeah,
they didn't win the team event.
To win a medal.
But he was not the only out LGBT medal winner.
We've got Eric Radford of Canada, yes?
Yes.
Yes, Eric Radford of Canada won the gold in the team figure.
His team won the gold, and as the gold winner, he was actually the first out gay winner at the Winter Olympics, Radford.
Of a gold medal.
First medal winner.
Oh, okay. He won the first medal
winner, out gay medal winner at the
first. We have to keep track of these.
Well, he's one of the dozen out LGBT competitors at the Winter Olympics, and the really biggest winner is Ireen Wüst of the Netherlands. Now, the Dutch are famous for their speed skating prowess. She is the biggest medal winner of the Winter Olympics overall. She's won 10 medals over many years at the Olympics. This year, as we tape on Valentine's Day, she has won a gold and a silver in speed skating.
Right.
And she is an out lesbian from the Netherlands. So congratulations to all of them. Congratulations for being so out. Thank you for the great publicity you've gotten and attention. And
they really have handled themselves with great poise and determination on this. You know, we can, you know, criticize some, you know, nuances of what they're saying, but I love the way that they're standing up for us, themselves, Pence, all that.
Of course, I watched the team figure skating pretty much through because it was fascinating and because I wanted to see Adam Rippon and Eric Radford and the others. And Mike Tirico, the NBC broadcaster, who's doing this too much on his own, and he needs a partner in the studio. He interviewed, first of all, early on in the team skating competition, he refers to Adam Rippon when he skates as, he's an outspoken young man, period. Then about 3 hours later, when the team has won the bronze and he's interviewing Adam in the studio, he says, you know, you're a little, feisty or whatever he said. I don't know.
And?
I can't quote him directly. Of course, you came out as gay a couple of years ago, but that's not what you're here for. You're here to skate for the U.S. of A. And you know, we're proud of you for doing that.
And Adam said, do I get a chance to talk here?
No. And Adam
Mike Tirico came out as Italian. Remember that?
No.
Last year. He said, you're watching Mike Tirico host this thing. You make your own judgments, but he says, I am not black, I'm Italian. He said that. He's big on golf. You know, he does the
British
Open.
Well, he does
a lot
of sports.
Yes.
I would certainly believe he is biracial, but not African-American.
That's what he says.
I don't think so. Who am I to judge?
Right.
But he was very reluctant to discuss with Adam Rippon his contretemps with Pence or his being an out gay Olympian. And I thought that's ridiculous. You know, it's so clear that these announcers are just cheerleaders for the Olympics and the USA right. and all their corporate sponsors. And they do not want to touch the anything resembling actual news at the Olympics about... Well. What's going on?
There were the Munich Olympics in 72, and they couldn't avoid that.
Well, exactly. But Rippon and Kenworthy, we showed you their picture together first. They posted that on Facebook or Instagram or wherever with the caption, "We're here, we're queer, get used to it." And I thought, I'm so proud of our children.
They invented the phrase.
I don't think I did, but somebody did. Maybe Ellen Klein? Maybe Mike Signorelli.
All right.
Someone at Queer Nation invented the phrase.
I do
a long
remember
time
the
ago.
Lesbian Avengers. 10% is not enough. Recruit, recruit, recruit.
We have fun. That's what's fun about activism.
Yes.
Yeah. Anyway, so.
And it seems to be a lot more than 10% these days.
Oh, my God. And it's, believe me, figure skaters.
Well, the news, of course, a couple of weeks ago was that Adam Rippon was the first out American figure skater for the men ever.
Well, because Brian Boitano and
Johnny Weir
came out after the Olympics. Not that everyone didn't know at the time, but they just wouldn't talk about it. Right. So maybe that. Those days are over, except there are certainly plenty there who are not out, who are
still competing.
Well, I
think they're like actors in some ways, and that's another profession where people don't come out. You're being judged constantly by others, rather than it's not like
I would say even more so in sports, and yeah. particularly, and when you're in these sports where the men are particularly sensitive about the fact that they're doing something that is regarded as gay.
Like ballet.
Exactly. So
Billy Elliot.
So Adam Rippon is still saying that he does not want to go to the White House if he, as a medal winner, is invited.
Don't go.
And instead he wants to hold an LGBT fundraising event. So
yeah,
we'll see what happens with that.
I'll tell you why they might not want to go to the White House. Let's talk about what's going on.
Okay.
The Trump administration has announced they're not going to fight these lawsuits around transgender in the military anymore, because they're going to announce a new policy on February 21st. And so they're not going to defend the old one.
This is very similar to their travel ban stuff, where when they first came into office and announced a ban on visitors and immigrants from particular countries, and everybody piled into the streets and to the airports to demonstrate and went to court to fight it. And the court said, no, you can't have this policy. It's religiously discriminatory, it's unconstitutional. Then they tweaked it and tweaked it and tweaked it and eventually got to a point where the courts would accept some version of it. So they're likely to go through the same thing with the trans travel ban. I suspect they will try to delay it.
Well, part of it is they claim there was some kind of a study going on, right? That there were, because they were basing it on nothing when they did the first ban.
Well, there have been studies, and the studies repeatedly, pre-Trump, during Trump, the whole thing have all said no problem with trans people
right.
serving openly in the military.
Right.
So they certainly could ask for another study before they allow open service. I think they will. This will all be a delay tactic. Mark your calendars. 1 week from the day we're taping today, there should be a new announcement.
We have another super bigoted Trump nominee. This is for the UN International Organization for Migration, Ken Isaacs. He is an acolyte of Franklin Graham, who was like a totally anti-Muslim bigot. This guy's a big right-wing Christian activist, and he's anti-Muslim. He's a climate change denier. And contrary to the United Nations, says that clean water and air is not a right. You have to work for it. He has to be confirmed by the 169 member states. This is not by the Senate. This is by the UN, because we give most of the money for this agency.
Yeah.
And so I hope that they can stop him.
Well, so far we haven't stopped Howard Nielsen being confirmed as a district court judge. A Senate committee has okayed him.
He's the guy who fought Prop 8 in court and tried to get it.
For Prop 8 in court.
Yeah, right. Fought to preserve Prop 8. And he tried to overturn Judge Vaughn Walker's decision because Judge Walker is gay and could benefit from the decision.
Wanted him to promise that he wasn't planning to get married, Vaughn Walker, before he could be allowed to judge
the case. Confirmed on the Judiciary Committee by a party line vote of 11 to 10, which is why the Senate elections in this year are so important, and we have an uphill climb if we're going to win them.
The Department of Education, as we said a couple of weeks ago, has now fully confirmed that they will not investigate or act on any complaints by transgender students about their access rights to restrooms that conform to their lived gender identity.
This had to be extracted from them by BuzzFeed because they didn't issue something. They just confirmed it. Betsy DeVos told the newspaper The Hill, "It's hurtful to me when I'm criticized for not upholding the rights of students and stop attacking people."
Well, they say their line of defense is we're just following the law. There is no federal non-discrimination law covering gender identity. Therefore, it would be overreaching for us to try to impose one. But as has been pointed out to them, to no avail. In fact, the Education Act Title 9 of the Education Acts, which forbids sex discrimination, have now been interpreted by multiple courts.
Two federal appeals courts.
To cover gender identity and expression. And those rulings have been put into effect to support trans people in their rights to non-discrimination.
Speaking of education, by the way, and it's not totally gay-related, but the Koch brothers and DeVos's American Federation for Children, her group, they're pushing something called education savings accounts, whereby you get credit for sending your kids to any school that you want to, as long as you just sign something saying, "I will never send them to public school." It's just, they're trying to destroy public education. That's what she's trying to do.
It's been her crusade for many years, and that's why she's the Secretary of Education in the Trump administration, to try to destroy public schools.
Now, we know that they want to destroy the Consumer Financial Protection Bureau because they gave it to Mick Mulvaney as a moonlighting job for him because he's the OMB director and may soon be the chief of staff by the time you see this. But they will no longer pursue cases against financial firms for breaking discrimination laws. They're also dropping cases against payday lenders. Good luck, suckers.
Well, they don't have anyone in the government anymore to pursue any of these complaints.
No, Mick Mulvaney says, "We work for those who use credit cards and those who provide them." That's his quote.
Well, and who's the number one whistleblower these days?
Number one whistleblower.
On what's going wrong in the government?
Omarosa. Ann taught me how to pronounce her name properly on the way up here today. Omarosa.
Well, I've been forced to start watching Big Brother again. I dropped that show years ago because it was so heinous. I watched the first couple of years, but I haven't watched it forever. And now with Omarosa on, I have to watch to keep track of all her comments about the administration.
Especially now, Mike Pence.
Well, that's the latest. The first was Trump himself, but now it's Pence. And now what she says about Pence is he lets Jesus tell him what to do. But she says, don't wish for Pence. He's going to be worse than Trump, which, of course, we've been saying all along. But the real debate is she saying all this just because she's trying to get a book contract? Yes. And is any of it true? Yes.
All right. The budget that President Trump submitted is terrible on all fronts and almost not worth talking about because it's going to be decided by the Congress. But it slashes Medicaid, Medicare, Social Security. The only people who are protecting us on that front are the Senate Democrats who can try to bring, 41 votes to bear to try to stop it.
Yeah, at least we're in 60 vote territory. Well, I was going to say this.
No more food stamps. You're going to get
boxes.
Yeah, boxes of box lunches.
And as someone said on The View today, what if there's peanut butter in the box and you're allergic to peanut butter, or your kid is?
Yes.
Not good. The proposed budget also slashes funding from AIDS programs around the world by $1.285 billion. This is money taken away from the State Department, USAID, the CDC, the Global Fund. But last year, they tried to do the same thing, and Congress restored the cuts.
Presidential budgets, in general, are called debt on arrival these days. It's the Congress that appropriates funds. The president makes his suggestions, but you should look at it to see what this guy is trying to do to you.
Well, the other thing is that if you're starting from $1.285 billion down, Congress may restore those cuts, but they're unlikely to increase the funding. So it serves as a damper on any kind of increase in these kinds of funds.
Remember when we had a president that we kind of liked somewhat? That was Barack Obama. Well, his, you know, you all saw that his official portrait at the Smithsonian National Portrait Gallery was unveiled this week. And the artist in this case was Kehinde Wiley, who calls himself a gay man who has occasionally drifted, but not bi, he says. I'm just quoting him. He's famous for featuring young black men and women, in including painting Ice-T as Napoleon after the Jacques-Louis David painting. And he says, I take people who look like me and allow them to occupy that field of power. I've seen his work in museums.
I think the Obama portrait is so beautiful and so wonderful.
Yeah.
And the Michelle portrait I'm warming up to. I at first was a little put off by the facial features.
Yeah, it's more about the dress.
Well, the dress is fantastic, but as I read about the artist's interpretation and motivations, I got into it more, and I got into the idea of how she was represented. They're both beautiful, beautiful paintings.
Yeah. They're interesting works.
And yes.
Mostly, they're just dull.
Mostly, others are just dull, yes.
Yes. Did you see Gavin Newsom's kickoff ad for his campaign?
Yes.
It's all centered around
most of it, yeah.
Same-sex marriage,
yep.
And having Del Martin and Phyllis Lyon get married there. This is 14 years ago, but this is how he's leading in his campaign
in
California.
Well, his whole theme is that he's brave and courageous and progressive and bold. Brave, courageous, and bold. long live his name. Long may his story be told.
Wider.
Thank you. I mean, it's about him being willing to go beyond, and I think that's a great, I wish all politicians would run on a theme more like that.
I mean, Kirsten Gillibrand did her 60 Minutes interview this week, and people like the execrable Chuck Todd are piling on, you know, about how she's changed her positions and things. We want people to change their positions. We want people to grow and to mature.
And she said she was embarrassed by her past positions.
And then he tried to play that as she's embarrassed by gun owners. She said, I'm a gun owner. I believe in gun rights, but not what we have in this country, which is this crazy, everybody's getting armed. Although it's nice to see gun sales are actually going down now.
Are they? That's
yes,
nice.
Yes, and one of the big companies declared bankruptcy. Because they're facing this big lawsuit.
Uh-huh.
But it's not over the killings in Sandy Hook.
Mm-hmm.
It's over some fault in their machinery.
Okay.
All right.
Virginia, your old stomping ground.
Yes, yeah, well, one of the most regressive, had been one of the most regressive when I was there in Charlottesville in the 70s. Virginia was pretty backward.
We all celebrated in November the huge turnover in the Virginia legislature of seats from Republicans to Democrats. But in the end, we came up one short in the House of Delegates.
One.
One vote.
One vote. No, it was a tie. And they flipped it, right? They did a whole blast.
Yes, I think so. Anyway, we lost the House of Delegates by one vote. And now that House of Delegates has killed four pro-LGBT non-discrimination bills that had passed the Senate.
Well, let's be fair to the other side, because Delegate Dave LaRocque said, it would be very disturbing to have a transgender person teaching kindergarten. These kinds of arguments are made on the floor, and the Republicans just say, I'm for that.
And they get away with it. Well, let's see if they get away with it. We'll have another election in a few years, and maybe we'll finally succeed in overturning the balance in the House of Delegates. Meanwhile, in Michigan, Governor Rick Snyder, who has been an apologist for the right wing for many years, has appointed an anti-gay extremist, Bishop Ira Combs Jr., to the Civil Rights Commission.
He said that gays who are complaining about him are economically advantaged people, unlike any other minority group. I mean, this canard has been going around for years, you know, that we live in the lap of luxury. You know, it's all based on, like, advocate surveys of their readers or something. It's not based on...
Well, it's marketing surveys that are looking for rich people to sell products to.
Right.
And in South Dakota, a bill has been proposed that would forbid instruction on gender identity or expression in the public schools in grades kindergarten through seventh grade.
It would be the first in the nation to do so, which means that you may be seeing it elsewhere, so watch out. A spokesperson for the Education Department said, we're not aware of gender identity being taught now. The sponsor,
you can't be too vigilant.
The sponsor said, we need to focus on reading, writing, and arithmetic. I'm for that, because if people did all those things well, they would not be following you.
But meanwhile, in Swampscott, Massachusetts, just a little northeast of Boston, the principal of the Stanley Elementary School, which is a kindergarten through fourth grade school, announced to the students and the school community that he is transitioning.
I guess as of now, this is now Shannon Daniels.
Yep.
52 years old.
And so Shannon wrote a letter to, but Shannon says, I don't care what pronouns you use. You can use he, she, they, whatever you want.
All right.
And I have a wife who identifies as non-binary.
And in the letter to the parents on how to talk about this.
From the school superintendent.
She did a letter and the school superintendent did a letter, which is great. But in her letter, she said, there are many different ways boys and girls express themselves. It is important we accept everyone as they are.
And the school community is fine with it. And everything seems copacetic in Swampscott, Massachusetts, for an elementary school dealing with a trans principal.
Less good in Miami.
Perhaps South Dakota should send a delegation to investigate.
Less good in Miami, and we have a picture of this this woman and this wedding. Jocelyn Morphy, she's a first grade teacher for 7 years at Saints Peter and Paul Catholic School. And so she married a longtime partner, Natasha Haas, on February 3rd, and the school asked her to resign. She wouldn't, and she was fired. She called it a difficult but necessary decision.
Well, how many cases have we seen like this over the years? A lot.
You know, she started a program there called Teach Hope that encouraged kids to feed the homeless, mm-hmm. encourage hope. The Miami Archbishop there, Thomas Wensky, compared the gay marriage decision from the Supreme Court there to the Dred Scott decision. Heinous. And, you know,
the school says she signed a contract promising to uphold Catholic principles.
I'm sure that they knew she was with this woman for a long time. That's usually the case.
Yes.
It's when you step forward and you get married and you affirm your love.
So activists, there is a sexual orientation non-discrimination law in Miami, but of course it has a religious exemption, so that's
how... religious exemptions are for ministerial positions, and that's always debatable. I know Catholic school teachers in New York who've won cases of discrimination.
Well, and maybe this one will too. She's a first grade teacher. The school, of course, will claim that, that she signed this contract promising to uphold Catholic teachings
she
and
did.
Principles.
She told people to feed the homeless.
That's true. And they will also, I'm sure, claim that a first grade teacher is a ministerial position. Now, LGBT activists in the area are using this case, which has, of course, gotten a lot of public sympathy for the teacher, to push for a statewide non-discrimination law, which has been under consideration in the legislature for a long time. Parents are very upset about this. But the fact that people don't understand that a Catholic school might fire a gay married teacher is a little naive. And as some have asked, what was she doing teaching there in the first place?
Well, exactly. Well, you know, I had been president of the Gay Student Union at the University of Virginia, and one of the first things, I thought I might still go back to my old boys' Catholic high school and teach English there. This is what I wanted to do. I was very associated with them. I was naive. And they had read my clippings from Charlottesville of gay activism, and they said, We thought you were trying to trick us into hiring you so that you could bring a lawsuit. It hadn't occurred to me. I was just 20 years old and naive, as Anne reminds me I am sometimes now.
I just wanted to teach field hockey. And then I found out it didn't pay anything.
Or gym at the Harvey Milk School.
Exactly. That's my point.
That's how we met.
Yes. So, but the other heinous thing about this story is that the school principal tried to conceal the reason for the firing originally. When they fired this teacher, they tried to cover it up and not admit the real reason that they were firing her, which is interesting because they could intuit that it would not be a popular reason to get rid of a teacher who was taking her kids to feed the homeless at a homeless shelter and who was beloved in the community.
Right. By the way, speaking of Miami and Catholics, we've been watching the assassination of Gianni Versace. I came across the fact that Andrew Cannon's cremated remains were welcomed at Holy Cross Catholic Cemetery in San Diego.
Really?
Yes. That's where he is, if you'd like to visit him.
All right. And I watched the, what was it on? Oxygen, maybe? An hour documentary about Cunanan and these murders. So
the show is getting a little too violent for me.
Well, the show is violent, and the murders were violent. The story is violent.
Yeah, but they do fantasy sequences, too.
Well, and there's been some question about how much is factual all the way through, but that's why I watched the documentary, and they did confirm a lot of the facts that are in the show. So I felt a little relieved about that. In North Carolina, ex-magistrate Gail Myrick has gotten a $300,000 settlement from the state because they did not accommodate her religious beliefs against performing marriages. They now have a rule.
A law,
That you can opt out of doing same-sex marriages as long as you opt out of doing all marriages.
For 6 months.
Yes. But they...
And a challenge to that law was rejected by the federal appeals court last year.
Yeah, but they had kicked her out immediately when she wouldn't do same-sex marriages. And, you know, she was a government employee clerk. And we would argue that she's required as a clerk to do all marriages. But this conflict between religious exemptions in the Constitution, religious freedom, versus being a public employee is the dicey thing.
Yes, it's the big thing in the country,
Supreme Court.
And Trump is pushing it like crazy. And believe me, folks, it's not just going to apply to gay people when they get through with this. All right, in Alabama, we told you about the students who were disciplined over making a prom proposal at the school talent show. Mm-hmm. Well, Lambda Legal has demanded a written assurances that they can go to the prom or face a temporary restraining order in the U.S. District Court. They're also asking for a written apology. The principal there, Holly, said over the PA system that this is a Christian school. It's not. It's a public school. And asked for prayer in these trying times.
Usually a threatening letter from Lambda will jerk people into reality, but we've heard nothing about any response.
It's supposed to be happening today. This is the deadline today. So
okay. Well, that doesn't sound promising if the principal is describing it as a Christian school.
Right.
Well, All right.
I was shocked this week that San Francisco is being sued for anti-transgender discrimination. The Department of Fair Employment and Housing at the state level is suing San Francisco because a city employee denied access to a trans woman, Tanesh Nutt. Nuttall to a woman's restroom and called her offensive slurs. She's a minister and a social worker who specializes in supporting the trans community. And
this was a city employee in a city building who...
calling her an effing man and an effing freak. And she says that she and her husband have left the city over the stress. This is a case from the Transgender Law Center. San Francisco.
Meanwhile, in Missouri, trans woman Jessica Hicklin has won the right to hormone treatment and other trans medical care at the Potosi Correctional Center. She's an inmate there, and she has... these cases are becoming more frequent where inmates who are trans are asking for... to be moved or to get treatment or whatever, and she has won her case.
Well, but they're saying she wasn't diagnosed with gender dysphoria before she went to prison. You know, but it's, you're in for life, you change, they don't want to hear about it.
Well, perhaps you have a little time to think about who you are in the more contemplative environs of the prison.
That is a Lambda Legal case. Jacksonville, Florida, we have the fourth transgender homicide this year. Celine Walker, 36, body discovered at a local hotel, fatally shot. Not ID'd as transgender until several days later.
Is that Celine, or is the, we also have the case from Buffalo of Tonya Harvey. Now I'm mixed up. I think that's, well, maybe that's Celine. Okay.
I apologize.
Well, the other case is from Buffalo, New York, of Tonya Harvey, 35 years old, known as Keita. She was shot dead.
Right.
Show us that other picture, if you can. There we go. Anyway, two murders of trans women in the last week. The count is mounting for 2018.
Okay, in Kentucky, a t-shirt company was sued in 2012 for refusing to print Pride t-shirts. And the Lexington Human Rights Commission ruled for the gay group, but Governor Matt Bevin is now urging the state high court to overrule that decision.
Well, this is the ongoing question of whether you're allowed, printing companies are allowed to refuse to print things with a message that they don't support. For instance, they're not required to print pornographic material.
I agree. I'm siding with the company here. If you're being asked to print a message or write a message or print a book and you don't want to do it, I believe you have First Amendment rights. I differ on the wedding cakes in that they want to reduce
cake is a cake.
They want to reduce everything to a creative act, and you could that never ends. In Colorado, the Republicans on the budget committee there in the state legislature voted to defund the Colorado Civil Rights Commission, which ruled against Masterpiece Cake Shop. They're also going to vote on whether to even authorize the commission to continue because it's sunsetting. Maybe we don't want this if it's going to do things like this.
Well, and now we're hearing stories like this around the country. A court rules against gerrymandering districts, and then the members of the legislature who don't like that ruling try to get rid of those judges.
Yeah.
This is the Republicans and the right wing fighting back against court decisions or commission decisions that they don't like by trying to destroy the institution that made those decisions.
Right. By the way, in the Vistaprint case, where the guys were about to have a wedding, got anti-gay propaganda instead, they've said they've done a thorough investigation. They're sorry for all the pain that was caused. The couple seems to have accepted this, that it was a mix-up with a third party. I don't know that happened, but... they are working with them to select LGBT charities in the United States and Australia, where they're from, including GLSEN, to make up for this, their pain.
Not just pay for the honeymoon?
All right, we better...
In New York City, we're about to begin the annual wrangling over the St. Patrick's Day parade, even though they have become more LGBT inclusive. The lesbian and gay Big Apple Corps marching band thought they had an invitation to march and perform in the parade, but now they've been told no, they don't.
Well, there is still the St. Pat's for All parade in Queens, and that's going to be on Sunday, March 4th at 1 o'clock in Queens, and the there's always a place for the Big Apple Marching Band.
The American Library Association has been holding its annual meetings, and they've issued their annual rainbow book list for kids. So if you're looking for LGBT inclusive and friendly books, you can check that out on the American Library Association's website. And congratulations to our friend Jackie Woodson, National Book Award winner and ambassador, U.S. Ambassador for Children's Literature, who got the Laura Ingalls Wilder Award for substantial and lasting contributions to children's literature.
Laura Ingalls, not Laura Ingraham. All right, international news?
Yes.
All right. In Malaysia, the leading newspaper there published a list of pointers for identifying gays and lesbians. Very heinous. Things are getting out of hand there. This could kill people, the way they're going after people.
In China, a court says that a gender identity and expression non-discrimination policy should apply in employment.
It's a breakthrough. This is a big breakthrough.
Upheld an award to Mr. C, who had sued. He's in the middle there. He had sued for discrimination, but says that he didn't prove gender discrimination.
So he's not getting an apology.
Right.
But this is a breakthrough in terms of looking at the law and saying that
trans
people deserve protection.
And in Pakistan, a Senate committee has okayed a trans rights bill, which will allow for self-determination by trans people without needing a lot of doctor's approvals, and sets up rules for non-discrimination of trans people.
The European Parliament has condemned Turkey's crackdown on LGBTI rights and wants the ban on LGBTI events rescinded. They also called on Russia to address anti-persecution in Chechnya. Good luck.
In Japan, the city of Fukuoka, which is one of the largest cities in Japan, has announced that starting April 1st, they will let same-sex couples register as couples. It's not marriage yet, but it is a large step forward.
And more is being written about the Silver Daddy murders, I'm calling them, in Toronto, where this guy, people disappeared, but he ended up, they've already charged him with 6 murders. But there was a really good article by a former investigator who said it is typical when people are marginalized, whether it's women or people of color or gay people, the police just don't do as thorough a job following up in terms of...
That's the Andrew Cunanan story.
Right?
They knew he was out there murdering people, but they didn't inform people widely enough. Miami police had not been informed that he was on the way there.
Right.
And he was not tracked down as he might have been before he murdered Versace.
Which is the redeeming feature of that series, and focusing on that.
In Uganda, vandals have broken into and trashed the office of the Human Rights Awareness and Promotion Forum, which did a lot of work for LGBT people and sex workers.
This is a very brave demonstration afterwards for these people standing outside, and because what happened was that they didn't just disable the security system, they slashed 2 of the security guards in the place and severely injuring them. And it's not the first time that this group has been attacked. 30 human rights groups have been broken into since 2012. And of those 30, no prosecutions on any of them. This is not just gay groups.
And a brewing scandal in Paraguay, where the president of a soccer club there has been accused of coercing players into sex. This is a male president and young men who want to play on the soccer team and have been told, you know, have sex with me and you can be on the soccer team.
AIDS news.
Yep.
Well, Kenneth Cole is out as the board chair of AMFAR. He's been chair for 14 years, but he was the New York State. That's him on the right with, you may recognize, Harvey Weinstein. This was all a controversy over Weinstein wanting to donate some things to be sold at an AMFAR benefit, but he wanted some of the money to go to somebody he had to pay off for something else. And Cole denied any wrongdoing, but he is stepping down.
under investigation by the New York State Charities Bureau. He looked a little nervous to me at Mathilde Krim's service. I was waiting for him to get up there and announce his resignation,
yes.
But it took a few more weeks. And in a big story in the New York Times, recommend you take a look at it. Insurers, health insurers are denying coverage to gay men who are taking Truvada as PrEP. Because
they're denying disability insurance and long-term health care insurance. If you don't, because that's somehow taking PrEP is an indication that you're more of a risk. You're more of a risk if you don't take PrEP.
But they say it's an indication that you're having lots of high-risk sex, because why would you be taking it if you weren't?
Well, this guy, Philip Chang, and he started taking PrEP because he nicked himself during a medical procedure. He's a, you know, but he says, I'm also gay, so I'll keep taking PrEP. And you know what he's done in order to get the insurance? He stopped taking PrEP. He's in a long-term relationship now.
Now he gets the insurance.
Oh, by the way, PrEP is going down around the world. In the Netherlands, it's going down from 500 euros to 47.95.
Down in cost.
Yes, 47.95. On Australia, from 10,000 a year to 475. In New Zealand, from 731 a month to $1.20. We need to do that here.
All right. The big news in entertainment, of course, is the interview with Quincy Jones, where he says Marlon Brando had sex with Richard Pryor and a lot of other guys like James Baldwin and Marvin Gaye.
Yes.
Do we detect a theme here? Yes, we do. And Richard Pryor's wife says, yes, Richard Pryor was bisexual and was fine about talking about
it. Well, Quincy said that Marlon would screw a mailbox. That's what he said.
Well, these were not mailboxes.
No, they were mails, though.
Sad story. Joel Taylor, one of the stars of Storm Chasers on TV, dead of a GBH overdose on a gay cruise. So stories about a lot of unrestricted drug use on cruises.
In award season news at the Writers Guild Awards, James Ivory won, openly gay, for Call Me By Your Name, which is, I guess, openly bisexual, for
and
Best Adapted
movie.
Screenplay.
Bad movie.
And Tracy Poust and John Canale won for Will and Grace. And the BAFTA Awards are this Sunday on BBC America.
Well, and the GLAAD LA Media Awards on April 12th will give the Vanguard Award to Britney Spears. That might be worth attending.
Right.
We came across a video that we wanted to show you, made by a filmmaker named Patrick Lee, part of a series called No Filters for the Hornet app, which is a dating app. And this is interviews with gay men of color talking about their experiences of racism in using gay dating apps. And we thought it was quite fascinating and thought you would want to see it. So here is Patrick Lee's 3-minute video.
So when I first moved to New York, it was an unspoken thing where, like, I'd be interested in someone. They're like, oh, you're cute, but you're Asian.
First time I ever used like any gay apps was about 2 years ago. My roommate, he would always, like, when we were watching TV, like, his phone was just constantly giving off the sound, the ho alert, as we called it. And, you know, I got curious too, so I'm like, okay, you know, whatever, so let me download this, let's see what's happening in my neighborhood.
I remember it being exciting and frightening at the same time, being on a gay dating app.
You know, in Puerto Rico, I mostly talked with other Puerto Ricans, yeah. So here, people, you know, call it, oh, like, you're so exotic, or I always go for Latinos, because that's, you know. And I didn't really know how to respond to that.
So the messages I got mostly, since I was Asian, was that it was immediately assumed that I was a bottom. So they're like, hey, do you want to take my 8-inch dick?
There's no discussion on, I guess, bed rolls, you know, based on my appearance. So I'm kind of pigeonholed into this, like, really aggressive role. Oh, you're definitely a top, or you're very, like, you look like you could really, like, tear me down in bed, or all these kind of things. And it's like, you know, like, I can totally be a bottom.
I was in the UK studying. I remember this very attractive guy had messaged me He stated that he felt very attracted to me, which is nice, but that he felt attracted to me because I looked like I could be European. The only way he could kind of regain his power was to not only ignore my identity, but to categorize me in some racial hierarchy.
In gay dating apps, approached by a certain demographic of men, white men in particular, about my blackness. They're disguised as compliments, like, oh, you black beauty, or something like that. Some of them go way further than that, and they're really explicit, you know, just like in reference to like black member, you know, part of my body. But they always make me kind of recoil, you know, like I am being fetishized.
Even my very own attractiveness isn't authentic. It's based on your European white standards of beauty.
You know, I have to say I find it a little shocking. It's not that I don't think people have preferences or fetishes or particular attractions, but to be so overt in saying this.
Well, it's so unattractive. It's such an unattractive quality to spurt things like that out.
So to speak.
Yes.
Sorry. Listen,
it's all right. Well, speaking of sex. No, but this is a very important issue, and there was a big, you know, there was another big article this week about, you know, if you put on your thing, on your, you know, dating apps, you know, I don't date blacks, Asians, you are a racist.
Of course.
You know, I mean, maybe you don't, but I mean, what a thing to put up, and it's something we all ought to think about if that's what you're obviously missing out on a lot. But then other people, when these things are posted on Facebook or anything else, the other guy says, well, we're just saving time. You know, we're just being honest.
Oh, my God.
Oh, God. It's terrible.
You know, swipe in the wrong direction if you don't want someone.
Something I never thought I'd see in the Times magazine. They do have a new publisher. It's about the effect of pornography on kids who watch it all the time.
Well, based on this story about a school that had a course in teaching kids, and this was a high school course, right?
Yes.
Teaching kids how to watch pornography or deal with it.
And the question is, how is it affecting the way certainly boys treat girls, or anybody treats anybody, by watching it and affects your performance. But there was something that jumped out at me, because in the course of talking about this, they said, to the teenager's surprise, they learned that receiving or sending consensual naked photos, even to your boyfriend or girlfriend, can be against the law if the person in the photo is a minor. Yeah! I mean, you can end up on a sex offender registry for doing stuff like that. So I think kids at least need to be taught what the legal boundaries are if they're not going to get themselves into a lot of trouble in the long run.
Absolutely, because to coin a phrase, they can be naive about these things.
Yes.
They don't know who's teaching them that this stuff is illegal. I just want to preview for you that with the reboot of American Idol on March 11th on ABC, one of the contestants will be young trans teen Colton McGrath.
And when Trump fires Mueller, just go out into the streets. Actually, there are demonstrations all across the country planned. If you can Google this, you can find out about it.
All
Thanks
right.
for being with us, and we'll be back with you next week.
Dry throat. See you next week.
Bye.